1887 marked a banner year for the Machinist Racing Team. It was a year of vast improvement in terms of image, attitude, and performance. Not only did we run more races than in past years, we ran more consistently and stronger. We sat on the front row for the first time in the history of the team with Pancho Carter in the Hardy's Machinist March, qualifying second fastest at Nazareth, Pennsylvania. We led the race in a show of skill and strength, battling back from being a lap down due to tire problems until we were hit by Dick Simon's car. We qualified strong and ran up front in the Michigan 500, again garnering rave reviews and national television exposure as Pancho brought the crowds to their feet with a thrilling dash to the front of the pack in a race he won in 1981. Pancho had 8 starts, led 2 of the races. He improved on his starting position in 5 of the 8 races, collected 9 points, won $214,040, and major television exposure. Jose Lee Garza, while not quite as spectacular, had the advantage of running all 15 races. He managed 6 top 10 finishes. He improved on his starting position in 10 of the 15 races, collected 46 points, finishing 11th in the point standings, and won $386,949 for the team. We didn't win a race, but neither did a lot of other teams, good teams. Only 12 of the 49 drivers to compete in the series ever led a lap. Only 7 of those drivers won a race. The Machinist Racing Team and the International Association of Machinists and Aerospace Workers were big winners in another way. We were stronger, quicker, more consistent. People took us seriously. Our competitors knew they had to beat us. In a larger sense, this presentation is about more than competition and racing. It's about the return on your investment. That return is measured in exposure. Machinist Racing Team has gotten that exposure in person at the track. Over 2.5 million people attended the 15 IndyCar races in 1987 for an average of 167,392 spectators per event. In fact, IndyCar race attendance was up over 200,000 people in 1987, the 7th consecutive year to show a major increase in attendance. Every one of those people saw the Machinist Racing Team in action. Exposure on television. We were featured on national telecasts of all the races in the CART series, with highly complimentary commentary from respected sportscasters, including 3-time Indy winner Bobby Unser, and on local television sports shows around the country. In addition, we received international exposure around the world through television coverage of CART events to all 10 provinces of Canada, Argentina, Australia, Brazil, the Caribbean Islands, England, Finland, France, Germany, Italy, Mexico, Puerto Rico, Sweden, and to military and government installations around the world through the Armed Forces radio and television networks. In the United States alone, CART marketing shows the viewing audience for the 1987 series over 210 million people. This viewership translates into over $96 million in commercial time to the teams and sponsors. With 1986 viewership of $113,552,000, IndyCar Racing gained 96,447,000 viewers in the 1987 season coverage. We'll talk more about this in just a minute. Exposure on radio, via race coverage and the myriad interviews with drivers and crew members, and the worldwide coverage of the Indianapolis 500 qualifications and race itself, carried on over 1,700 radio stations, including the Armed Forces Radio Network. Exposure in print. When the race is over, the mass coverage is just beginning, with hundreds of publications covering the IndyCars. We reap expanded coverage in nearly every daily newspaper in North America, plus national publications such as USA Today, Newsday, Sports Illustrated, Car and Driver, Road and Track, Auto Week, On Track, the Associated Press, and the United Press International. Newspaper special racing sections devoted to CART IndyCar racing have increased from 4 in 1983 to 35 in 1987, with more planned for next year. In addition, non-sport publications such as Business Week, The Robb Report, The Wall Street Journal, People Magazine, Contrails, Learjet's publication, In-Flight Magazine, carried by 46 regional air carriers, Playboy, Penthouse, TV Guide, Manhattan Incorporated, Industry Week, Time Magazine, Advertising Age, Ad Week, and Sports Marketing News have all published stories pertaining to IndyCar racing. We were also featured in race programs for each of the races, the Indy 500 Yearbook, and CART, the men and machines of IndyCar racing 1987-88, who said, Andy Kenepensky's Machinist Union team was again a strong midfield contender, showing excellent form. His lean and competitive team was living proof that modest budgets can produce results. Mexican Jose Ligarza again drove a march under the direction of chief mechanic Mark Bridges, and they got off to a great start. Pancho Carter, with backing from Hardee's, ran an 87 march several times out of the machinist shop. He was brilliant at Nazareth. Front row qualifying was followed by an early lead. Pleasant reward for chief mechanic John Barnes.
As Pancho Carter jumps into the lead, Michael Andretti drops into close pursuit now, the first time down the only straight part of this track. As Pancho Carter has jumped off of the start from the outside and is leading already here at Pennsylvania International Raceway. So Pancho Carter, a real surprise at this point, with Michael Andretti trying to catch up.
To say that Pancho Carter threw a good old sprint car start on Michael. That's Michael in Formula Atlantic starts. Pancho sprint start. That was a nice start. Good one.
Elsewhere, describing the action at Nazareth, they wrote, Pancho Carter in the Hardee's Machinist Union March had the crowd out of their seats in a front-running display of oval track toughness. Carter and the fast-developing Machinist Union team appear to be a happy combination. Andy Kenepensky heads the serious no-frills operation devoted to extracting a lot of speed from a limited budget. Carter could be the catalyst to make them regular contenders for front-row starting spots.
Pancho was one of the finest sprint cars we ever had. He's driving for the Machinist Union team, which is John Barnes is the chief. He's very good mechanic, very good chief for this type of track also. I think their program is finally coming together on this team.
As we recap the season visually with a look at just a small portion of the television exposure gotten by the Machinist Union team, we'll be giving you some of the dollar values assigned to this coverage. The dollar value given this exposure is based on the cost of a 30-second commercial to a sponsor or ad agency in that race telecast. This is the system employed by the two firms who track such information for sponsors or teams. This uses the amount of in-focus time, interviews, and mentions of the Machinist Union racing team, machinist-related sponsors, drivers, and crew members. Beginning with the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach, April 5th, we got 1 minute 10 seconds of national TV exposure valued at $58,450. At the Phoenix 200, machinists got 30 seconds of exposure worth $35,100. The third race of the season is the Indianapolis 500 on May 24th. Not only does the fame and importance of this race raise the commercial costs, it is preceded by 3 weeks of high visibility practice and 4 days of qualifications. And then, finally, the largest one-day sporting event in the world, the Indy 500. During the first week of practice, during a particularly windy session, Pancho lost control of the Hardee's Machinist March in Turn 3. Getting airborne, the car flipped over and sailed about 100 feet before falling back to the track and sliding for some 860 feet on Pancho's helmet and the pop-off valve. Shaken but unhurt, Pancho was back on the track 2 days later in a Machinist backup car. Captured on film by still photographers and videotaped by television crews, the accident was replayed countless times worldwide. The still photos ran in over 270 daily newspapers in the U.S. alone, countless others around the world. It also covered nearly 2 color pages of Sports Illustrated magazine's May 18th issue. It was featured again in the year-end Sports Illustrated Year in Pictures issue. It ran twice in USA Today in color each time. The television footage was featured on local television stations' sports shows nationwide and on ESPN's Speed Week and qualifying coverage. Hardee's marketing experts said the exposure from that one incident alone was worth over $4.5 million to their firm. The 4 days of qualifications yielded machinists 21 minutes and 15 seconds worth of national television exposure worth $431,550. The Indianapolis 500 itself, telecast live on May 24th, gave us another 5 minutes and 39 seconds of coverage worth $1,244,130. At Indianapolis, we garnered more than $1,675,680 worth of network television coverage alone. Add to this the radio and print exposure around the world, and the figures are staggering. On to the Milwaukee 200, May 31st, where the Machinists got another 25 minutes and 13 seconds, worth $124,066. The television coverage of the June 14th Portland 200 gave us 22 minutes and 18 seconds of exposure, worth $109,716. At the Meadowlands Indy, June 28th, it was 1 minute 43 seconds, worth $86,005. The Cleveland Grand Prix, July 5th, was 1 minute 29 seconds with a value of $74,315. The Toronto Indy Race, July 19th, gave us 31 seconds of exposure worth $25,885. The season progressed to the Michigan 500, August 2nd, and a strong showing in the race, getting us 13 minutes and 3 seconds of television exposure worth $916,410. Next was the Pocono 500 on August 16th, where our exposure was 4 minutes and 59 seconds with a value of $249,665. August 30th found the Machinist Union Racing Team at Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin for the Road America 200, where we received 16 minutes and 6 seconds of in-focus time with a value of $79,212. At Mid-Ohio on September 6th for the Escort 200, we got 30 minutes and 52 seconds worth $151,864. For the inaugural race at the Pennsylvania International Raceway, September 20th, Pancho sat on the front row, a first ever for the Machinist team, and battled for the lead for over half of the race before an untimely accident took us out of contention. All told, we got 16 minutes and 20 seconds of prime television coverage worth $818,300 and some very favorable comments from commentators Bobby Unser and Paul Page. Crossing the country for the October 11th race at Monterey's Laguna Seca Raceway, we picked up another 1 hour and 6 seconds of exposure valued at $270,450. The season finale found the Machinist team at Tamiami Park, Miami. We gained another 1 minute and 52 seconds, worth $93,520. In addition to our strong showings, favorable announcer mentions, and driver and crew interviews, we were also the onboard camera car for a number of the races, which accounted for the much larger exposure time at those races. The grand total? The Machinist Union Racing Team, Machinist-related sponsors, drivers, and crew, garnered a whopping 3 hours, 43 minutes, and 11 seconds of television exposure, worth $4,688,338. Now that's a return on your investment. Keep in mind that these numbers do not include any of the viewership in Canada or around the world, nor do they include any of the coverage of the Hardys' involvement in the Special Olympics program. We received national coverage of the press conference held at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway with Eunice Kennedy Shriver, a longtime friend of the Machinist Union, and of the games themselves, which featured a Hardys Machinist show car for the entire week. Nearly every one of the Special Olympics athletes had their picture taken sitting in the Machinist show car. These photos were then distributed with a news release to their hometown newspapers nationwide, promoting not only the Special Olympics and the athletes' involvement, but also the Machinist Union. In addition, Pancho spent 3 days at the games donating his time as a celebrity host, and the Machinist racing team stopped for a day en route home from the Michigan 500 to display our tractor trailer rig and the 1987 Hardys Machinist March race car to the press and public. Again, Pancho was on hand granting interviews, signing autographs, and posing for photos with the car and fans. We also received several very positive mentions during the telecasts of various races on our involvement and participation in this unique sporting event. ESPN aired a special interview with team manager Andy Kanapensky, filmed in the Machinist Racing Team shop in Indianapolis after Pancho's untimely flip, showing and explaining the structural weakness of the roll bar system of the 1987 March and how the Machinist mechanics had redesigned the roll bar structure to make it safer. They also presented an interview with Pancho and the helmet, ground through the shell in several places, which quite possibly saved his life. ABC aired a similar piece in their coverage of the Indy 500. At season's end, the Machinist Union Racing Team also captured the coveted PPG Refinish Award, presented to the best appearing car of the entire kart series. The best, another first for the Machinist team. The six Machinist Union Racing Team show cars spread strategically across North America, making appearances at all the major car shows, picnics, parades, and civic events, were seen by nearly 9 million people last year. The racing team itself participated in a two-day Aviation Career Opportunities Exposition with the Indiana Air National Guard, several auto shows, and a number of civic and sponsor-related appearances in 1987, generating goodwill and enhancing the positive image of the union. At a number of these appearances, we were able to borrow a commercial Polaroid camera and sold pictures of people sitting in the Machinist show car with Pancho, who then autographed the photos for the happy fans. With help from friends of the team, such as Hubler Chevrolet, who underwrote the cost of the film and camera rental, we were able to donate the proceeds to a local charity. Altogether, we raised several thousand dollars, which were donated on behalf of the Machinist Union Racing Team. Making friends. Machinist Union Racing Team and show car teams handed out over a million beautiful color race cards, featuring color photos of Jose Lee Garza and his number 55 Schaefer Machinist March, and Pancho Carter and his number 29 Hardy's Machinist March, to fans all across North America. The Machinist Racing Tractor Trailer Rig logged nearly 150,000 miles last year, crisscrossing the country like a moving billboard, and was parked strategically in the infields of the racing facilities, where it was seen by fans attending the races and TV viewers as well. All in all, it was a very good year. We were stronger, we were faster, we were more consistent, and people did take us seriously. We grew, we matured, we improved, and we never let down. At each successive race, we tried a little harder. We came together as a team. Each man knew that every one of his teammates would put forth their absolute best every time. One look in the driver's eyes, and we knew they would wring every last ounce of speed and maneuverability from the cars we prepared for them. As a racer once told us, there's first, and there's all the rest. As the 1988 season dawns, fresh and challenging, we're racing into the future. We're redoubling our efforts to be number one for ourselves, for our families, and most importantly, for the 1 million members of the International Association of Machinists and Aerospace Workers around the world who believe in us.